Welcome everybody to the board. I should say by way just of start that the chair, as chair, we've resolved that at this stage the public will be attending not in person but actually via the screen. But I should add that actually it's our current intention that the next time we meet, actually we will be doing that, enabling the public to join us physically, which would I think be very good. We will have a number of apologies for absence, and that includes from Andrew Morris and Jeremy Townsend, Pat Carter, Munir Per Mohammed, Steve Powis, and Lord Darcy. Can I ask if anyone on the board has any interest to declare in addition to those interests already declared, or have any interest in any of the items in this meeting? Thank you. I'll take silence as confirmation of no additional interests. And then can I ask the board to approve the minutes of the board meeting of the 24th of March? Any objections? I can see lots of nodding. Very good. Thank you very much. What I'd like to do, if you would humour me, is I'd just like to provide a very brief survey or review of some of the activities I've been undertaking as chair over the last 5 or 6 weeks, and partly actually to share with you then some reflections as to areas of focus. In terms of meetings, I think I've met a high volume of meetings and met now with all of the 7 regional directors, clearly with the NHSE and NHSI non-executive directors, where we've had a number of conversations with the full executive team, which has been very good, and that's again on multiple occasions. And then also with other national directors and HEE and NHS digital colleagues. In terms of reviews, I've had good conversations with Claire. So for the fuller stock taken, you'll see that Claire, and I'm delighted she's here, is going to give us an update on her stock take later on in this meeting. A couple of very good meetings with Gordon Messenger concerning his review, conversations with Laura around her digital technology review, and they've all been very informative. And then on primary care, we've had one round table so far, and there are a couple more round tables involving people from outside NHS England actually helping to inform me about thoughts and thinking with regard to the challenges that we can see currently in primary care. And then it won't surprise you that there have been a number of meetings with Treasury and Number 10, and in particular with the department, DHSC. I was able to attend and delighted to attend, I think at the inaugural meeting actually, of the meeting of the ICS chairs and CEOs, so a leadership event, and that was really, really helpful. And I've also met with several of the ICS leaders in different regions over the last 6 weeks, either virtually by way of a Zoom or Teams call, or actually on a number of other visits. So last weekend I was up in Blackburn, again meeting with Lancashire and South Cumbria ICS. And clearly, I've also been to the West Midlands and to Birmingham and Solihull and met with the ICS there. I'm quite keen on frontline engagement. It's something I'd also be really keen to encourage the non-execs to do. And so an ambulance shift, which I've mentioned in the past, was very informative to me, actually. Very interesting reflections following that. And clearly, when I've gone out into systems, meeting frontline colleagues, either within the hospitals themselves and or actually in the primary care networks. And I did attend actually last week, it was a patient's AGM in a very good practice. It was in central London, where I did Q&A with about 60 or 70 of the patients, which again was very interesting to get direct reflection from them of their questions about the health service. And then there are some very important stakeholders as well that I've been keen to meet and have met. So the NHS Assembly, NHS Confederation, I've met with other arm's length bodies, so NICE, with CQC, with HEE. and also with the voluntary experiments of the voluntary sector, so for instance, most recently with Cancer Research UK, and then obviously also the think tanks. And I read quite a lot of their research, but I've also met with Health Foundation, Nuffield, King's Fund, and so on, which has been very good. In terms of themes that I've increasingly focused on, clearly workforce is really important, and we've initiated, and that will come up, I'm sure, in Amanda's CEO report, but we're initiating work on long-term planning for workforce, urgent and emergency care, and also primary care access have become significant themes for me to focus upon. Also looking at the organisational merger of the five entities, and also now beginning to look at estates. Let me finish with just some reflections on main areas of focus for me. And in terms of what I'm about to highlight as main areas of current focus, I mean, it doesn't mean that items I don't reference are not still truly important. So for instance, life sciences and digital and cancer, I'm not going to mention those as my immediate areas of focus, but they remain very important areas where clearly NHSE keeps very significant itself focus upon those. So where are my immediate personal areas of focus? I don't think they will come as a surprise. And I shared this with the board and members of the board over the past few days. Elective backlog, really important to improve the position in elective backlog and to reduce the waiting list. And I know Jim Mackey, who's on this call, is leading on that initiative with David Sloman, and we'll get an update on that. Urgent and emergency care is the second. And then the third is primary care access. And I add access there because it strikes me that is a very immediate topic to focus upon. And what we'll have, I'm sure, when Claire speaks to us a bit later on in this meeting, is not just a view on access, but actually sort of broader model suggestions for how primary care itself might evolve. So if those are three areas. There are then two very important mechanics, which the board is very focused upon and are immediate tasks that we need to oversee. The first I've already mentioned, which is the merger of the five entities, NHSE, NHSI, improvement, NHS Digital, NHSX, and HEE. And the second, I'll call it piece of machinery or structural machinery, is going to be giving birth essentially to the ICS, so that we see the ICS has come to fruition and operate as a fundamental structural change within the system. And clearly, the board, I think, will necessarily and importantly be highly focused on that. And then there are two underlying, I call them thematic priorities, one of which is workforce. And what I find in my first 6 weeks is the number of questions where actually you come back into the question of workforce. And so actually that remains a very important underpinning priority. And then the second is a sort of a one-word thematic, but it plays on multiple levels. And I think one of the things that I reflect upon after these first 6 weeks is the question of capacity. And it can either be capacity of a first order nature, which can be, for instance, the number of beds, or it can be the number of scanners we have in the system enabling diagnostic services, or it can work on a second order level, which is actually if one changes working practices or we introduce more technology, then actually you can lift capacity without actually necessarily lifting the actual physical, the physical capacity itself, but essentially the operating capacity can be lifted. So I think one of the areas I'm keen to encourage the board to reflect upon over future meetings will be deep dives into aspects of capacity for the service and how we're positioned and what we can then do about it. So those would be my initial areas of focus or priorities. I've shared a number of those with members of the board earlier today and in separate meetings, but obviously I'd be keen to take any reflections that colleagues have on what they think of that that prioritisation. So let me pause at that point for my chairman's introduction. Wait and see if any of my non-exec colleagues have any reflections or comments, and if not, then hand to Amanda for her chief executive's update. Okay, Amanda, over to you, I think.
Great, thank you, Chair. And just, I've got a bit of an echo. Shall I just try again? Oh yeah, that's great, thank you. So I'm actually going to start by just saying, of course, on behalf of the executive group, I would like to formally welcome you to the role, Richard. Although given your extensive engagement both across the NHS and with the team here, I think it is hard to believe this is only your first board meeting as chair, but I know colleagues have been hugely grateful for the interest you've already shown in their work and the big challenges the NHS is grappling with at the moment, and are very much looking forward to working with you. If I may mention,
Amanda, it's Richard. Can I just interrupt you for a moment? That will throw you as we're sitting in different rooms. Actually, one thing I do want to quickly do, and it's reciprocity for your, very kind comments to me just then. I just like to thank the board, actually. And I was looking at the board's engagement, and if I look back at last year, this board essentially had five formal board meetings, two board strategy meetings, another two full board deep dive sessions, and then there have been separate board calls on a number of sort of more immediate tasks. And then I look at the audit committee, which has met, I think, six times over that period. The digital committee has met three times. The people remuneration nominations committee has met three times. The quality and innovation committee four times. And the very good advisory group, the joint finance advisory group, which supports Julian as finance director, has met two or three times. We have a deep dive next week on UEC as a board. So again, I'm hugely grateful to colleagues for that. I referenced earlier Laura's leadership in doing the digital technology review. We have David Behan and Jeremy Townsend working alongside the execs on the workforce, the longer-term workforce planning, and Wal Collada is going to be leading a study or review on the question of estates. So you thank me kindly for getting engaged in the first 6 weeks, but I do want to just thank colleagues actually for the amount of work they do that's often not seen, I think, in simply the appearance at the board meeting. So I'm very grateful to colleagues for all their commitment. Back to you, Amanda.
Oh, no, thank you. Thank you, Richard, and well said. I just wanted to mention, in welcoming you, also a couple of other senior appointments that we've announced today. So we have today announced the appointment of a new Chief Strategy Officer, and we're going to welcome Chris Hobson, who is currently the Chief Executive of NHS Providers, on the 13th of June. And then the other appointment that we've announced, and I think this is also a really important one, given what you've already said, Richard, about your personal focus on primary care and primary care access, is we have appointed Amanda Doyle, Dr. Amanda Doyle, who is currently the regional director in the Northwest, as the national director for primary care and community services. So that as a dedicated role overseeing the leadership of that group within NHSE. Sadly, today, though, is the day we will say goodbye to Ian, at least from the board. He will continue to work here, of course, and work with us, supporting us, as he has done brilliantly over the years until the end of June. But this is, I think, Ian, your last board. So just to note that, and thank you for all of the things you have done over the years, for which we will miss you enormously. But just sort of moving on to the bulk of my report, Richard, I'd like to start, if I may, by just providing an update on the NHS response to COVID-19. When we last met, we had just begun the spring booster vaccination campaign, and we've now delivered over 3 million top-up doses to those in the highest risk groups. So that is equivalent to 79% of those eligible age 75 and over. And given what we know about the impact of vaccination on the severity of disease, I think, you know, that continues to be, alongside what we have done with the COVID medicine delivery units, which have now delivered antiviral and antibody treatment to 140,000 1,000 of those people at the highest clinical risk who would benefit. That combination continues to be absolutely critical to keeping our most vulnerable people safe from COVID, and also is playing into what we are now seeing as a significant reduction in the number of people with COVID in hospitals. That peaked, as we'll recall, at 16,587 on the 6th of April, and it's now declined steadily down to below 5,500. So as a result of that sustained fall, both in inpatient numbers and also, of course, community infections as well, and on the advice of the National Incident Director and his team, and obviously in conjunction with David, as Chief Executive, I have taken the decision now to reclassify the NHS incident level from a level 4 national incident to a level 3 regional oversight, and that is effective immediately. So David and I have written out this morning to local leaders to let people know about the change, and we are speaking to them later this afternoon on a webinar to go through that in more detail. What we stressed in our letter is that while we need obviously to be vigilant and be able to step things back up quickly if it looks like being necessary, we are at a point now where as a system we can not step down but step across. So we're putting that resource and time that has been focused on the COVID response to the service of our recovery priorities, particularly focusing on key patient access and quality measures, and also to reform and building for the future with ICBs and ICSs at the centre. We'll say more about that, I know, in a moment. So what that means is, of course, we're looking at what we can roll back in relation to incident management and reporting requirements, mindful of what I was saying about the need to turn that back on quickly if we need to. But for our local colleagues, it means taking the same. And we have seen, as you mentioned it a moment ago in your introduction, we've seen time and time again the commitment to doing this, but that same energetic and rigorous approach to recovery and to delivering the specific ambitions set out in the planning guidance for this year and the elective recovery plan published in February, as they have done to the COVID response. So that same spirit of innovation and relentless focus on doing the right thing for patients, supporting staff, but now focused on recovery and reform, where it has been focused, of course, on the COVID response. Although not only on COVID response, because one of the things I wanted to mention in my opening remarks is the remarkable things that I have seen personally as I have been out and about over the course of the last few weeks, as you have also, Richard, and the things we have already seen very much up and running across the health service in that spirit of recovery and reform. But just on the letter, we are not adding any new objectives to the letter. We're just asking that the latest guidance, particularly on IPC and ensuring visiting access, is implemented in full. And I just did want to say a word on visitors, because allowing visitors as well as loved ones accompanying those attending planned appointments is really important to patient experience, mental health and recovery, not to mention, of course, the benefit clinicians get from having the right input and insight into their patients from those who know them best. So as well as the value to patient care, this is about the core NHS values of compassion, dignity, respect. And whilst COVID is still circulating in the community, of course, we will understand the need to balance risk. Our starting point has to be, what do patients want and need? And the vast majority of inpatients will want and will need to see visitors. So colleagues are, of course, I think well aware, and we'll talk more about it in the meat of the board meeting today, of our recovery challenge. But I did want to pull out just a few things by way of introduction. So firstly, on cancer services, they've obviously been prioritised throughout the pandemic for obvious reasons. But what we do know is that many people were reluctant to come forward. And a lot of people said, in fact, about half of people said they didn't come forward, even if they had worrying symptoms, because they didn't want to burden the NHS. Now, we've said throughout the pandemic, people should come forward if they were worried about their health. But the good news is that now that trend has very much reversed. So we now have more people than ever before coming forward for cancer checks, with 250,000 urgent referrals in March alone, and that is the most on record for a single month. And we really want that to continue. And that is why our campaigns and awareness work, which we continue to do with our fantastic partners and charities, is so important. And I particularly wanted to highlight the news you might have seen this morning that a record 25,000 men were sent for prostate checks in March. And that's because our campaign, which we launched in February in partnership with Prostate Cancer UK and a number of famous faces, has encouraged 500,000 men to check their risk online. So as we've seen time and time again, better awareness of symptoms and encouragement to come forward saves lives. I'm sure the board will also just want to join me then in commending the incredible work that Deborah James has done to raise awareness of bowel cancer over the last 6 years. And this is clearly a very difficult time for Deborah and for her family, but her willingness to share her experiences since diagnosis and even now has undoubtedly saved lives, and it will continue to do so. So this week alone, we've seen an estimated 82,000 extra visits to the NHS bowel cancer page on our website. And for most people who come forward for a check, it's not cancer. But for those who do get a diagnosis, getting treatment as early as possible is key. So anyone watching this, please, if you're worried, do come forward, because the sooner you do, the better it could save your life. So just secondly, on urgent and emergency care services, we know they are still under immense pressure. What that means is the individuals who deliver them are under immense and unsustainable pressure as well. And I'm thinking here particularly about ambulance staff, as well as, of course, those in emergency departments and acute wards. Demand is high. Last month was the busiest ever April for ambulance services in terms of calls and Category 1 incidents, and the second busiest for A&Es. But that isn't the whole story, and we've talked about this as a board before. We did see some improvements from March to April on key measures like the A&E treatment time, handover delays, and ambulance response times across all categories. But the further rise in 12-hour admissions from A&E to a ward underlines that flow is still a real issue here. And we've talked before about how we can trace the line from delayed discharges all the way through to slower ambulance response times. And Matthew Taylor, who's the Chief Executive of the NHS Confederation, was on the radio last week saying that increasing capacity in social care to support discharge was where he would concentrate. And I have to say that certainly matches what local leaders are telling us.
And Amanda, sorry. And we have, I reference, we have this deep dive next, I think it's next Wednesday, on urgent emergency care, which I'm really looking forward to. And I think our pressure point, our deep inquiry, what are the actions or what are the quick wins? And then what are the, not necessarily the quick wins, but the sort of, you've used the phrase, the signature moves as well, that might make for more medium-term improvement. But it's as much, what can we do, what can we look at doing now that can quite quickly try and get on top of this issue? And there are some very difficult systemic problems that sit there, but are there some sort of interventions that we can go after that might help more quickly to improve the picture? So I'm looking forward to the deep dive, as colleagues are, I think, next Wednesday.
Yeah. So, Richard, you're right. I mean, clearly, what I was going to go on to say is there are some big questions that we need to look at around physical capacity, whether we've got the right number of hospital beds, treatment spaces in A&E and in other urgent care settings. We're obviously actively looking at that now. The second big question we need to look at is, have we got the workforce? And when I say we, I do mean actually very much we, as in the health and care team, because as I say, an awful lot of the challenge is in the domiciliary care support, and that is mostly provided by colleagues in social care. So there are some really big questions that we obviously need to work through that go talk to the medium and long term. But in the meantime, this is going to require absolutely continued collaborative work at system level to do everything we can to ensure people are treated in the right place for them and at the right time, and do, as you say, everything we can to make sure we're collectively relieving pressure on the urgent emergency care pathways, and whether that's the continued utilisation of the new urgent community response teams, the two-hour response teams that we've set up across the country, whether that's helping as many people as possible through urgent treatment centres, direct bookings into community pharmacy or other community settings where they're likely to be seen more quickly, making sure we've done things like fully reinstate same-day emergency care, acute frailty services, so people can get help directly without necessarily having to go through A&E, but tailored support for what they need. But also making sure, of course, that we leverage the significant investment that we're making this year in virtual wards as part of that wider effort to speed up discharge and provide alternatives to admission, as well as relieve pressure on bedded capacity. So, Richard, I think lots to talk about in the deep dive, but I thought it was just important to put on record the recognition we have, the impact that is having on our workforce now, as well as on our patients.
Thanks,
of course.
Amanda.
Just thirdly, then, on planned care, monthly performance data for March published last week showed we continue to make progress towards the first milestone in the elective recovery plan. That's the elimination of over 2-year waits, other than, of course, by patient choice or for highly specialised treatment by July. We're going to talk about that later, and Jim is with us. He's been leading that work with Pauline and others. So we saw a record March against key diagnostic test activity up by 217,000 on the previous month. And although we know, as I've just said, that April was a very challenging month due to urgent care demand and COVID peak, the indications are that we did remain on track. And that's thanks to an immense amount of hard work and continued innovation by teams across the NHS. I just said I've been lucky enough to see a lot of that myself since we last met. Coincidentally, and on a different day, I was up in Blackburn a couple of weeks ago. I saw how they'd, for example, remodeled their intensive care unit so they could use it more flexibly to support complex elective surgery, a real learning from the pandemic there. At Lymington New Forest Hospital, they showed how they're linking up services like endoscopy, audiology with their community diagnostic centre to deliver literally thousands of additional tests. In Norwich, I saw colleagues took me round to show me how they're using robotic surgery, virtual wards, personalised outpatients to really maximise the number of patients that they can treat, but also do it in new and innovative ways that work for patients as well as working for staff. And that's just three examples of the innovations that I've seen going on at every stage of the pathway to tackle the COVID backlog, but do it in a way that provides better services for the future as well. I mean, we know, you said it a moment ago, we know that that is not the extent of the recovery challenge. It exists in mental health, community services and in primary care too, which we'll be talking to Claire about a little bit later. And COVID is not the extent of the unpredictable pressure the NHS faces. So we discussed inflationary pressures at the last board meeting, and I know Julian will talk more about that today. But I also did want to mention, of course, that you'll be aware that the UK Health Security Agency has now issued a number of updates in the last couple of weeks about monkeypox. So NHS teams are working very closely with colleagues at UCSA on contact tracing for identified cases, securing vaccines for staff who've been exposed. These cases are being handled and managed with, you know, the utmost professionalism by NHS staff and our colleagues. The risk to the public is very low, but it is another reminder that COVID isn't the only thing occupying the NHS at any one time. And that, of course, has been the case throughout the last 2 years. So, Richard, just before I end, I think it is just worth acknowledging, and I just wanted to make sure I'd had the chance to do this, that since our last meeting, the Health and Care Act has gained royal assent. It's been a long journey from the proposals initially set out in the long-term plan, but we are at a very, very exciting point where integrated care boards are now just weeks away from legally existing. And by the time we next meet, they will have been running for a week. So I just want particularly to put on record my thanks to Ian for all the work that he and his team have done to support that, and to Mark Coven and the system transformation team for, again, all the work that they have done to support the system transformation to be ready to take advantage of this huge opportunity that I think we now have. And as you said, the engagement and energy we see every time we meet or visit with ICB leaders gives me real confidence that they have the drive, the skills to really make the most of the opportunity that this legislation gives them and us. And that's good, because they have an incredibly important task ahead of them, taking partnership working to the next level, delivering not just recovery, but also meaningful reform and new ways of doing things, building on the lessons and achievements and learning from the pandemic so that we can both improve services and outcomes for the communities that we serve, that they serve, and so that we can do that not just for now, but for the future as well. So it's a hugely, I think, challenging time, Chair, but also, as I hope you have already felt, and I think you've already said, an incredibly exciting one too.
Amanda, thank you. I've also now got an echo, but I will pause and see if anyone wants to ask you and reflect on your comments or ask you any questions from the board. And if not, I'm going to move us into the operational performance update, where I know there will be some challenge back, I think, either to David or to Jim and or to Julian, who will give us an update on the finances. David, do you want to kick off on operational performance update?
Yes,
and
yes,
you've got Jim with you, obviously, which is very good.
No, happy to. Thank you, Richard. As ever, you have the report before you, colleagues, which is comprehensive in its breadth and its nature. Amanda, in her introductory comments, has talked about where we find ourselves with COVID and also touched on where we are with urgent care, which is better last month than the month before, but still not where we need it to be, and still a system which is very, very pressurised, which we fully acknowledge. I'm really pleased to say, Richard, that later on the agenda, we're having a fuller discussion about maternity and neonatal services, and as promised last time around, a good chunk of time on mental health and mental health recovery, and we will be touching on primary care. So my intention is to focus on where we are with elective recovery, and particularly the work that we've done to aim to clear our 104-week waiters and our plans as we move into the 78-week waiter challenge. And in that spirit, I'm going to hand over to Jim, who's been leading our work on this in partnership with colleagues across the NHS, to talk about where we're at and what the next stages of that work like. And then I'm very happy to come back at the end, Richard, to pick up on any other issues which colleagues might wish to discuss or raise. So if that's okay, Richard, I'll hand over to Jim to lead this
part. That's great. Yeah, thanks. Jim, to you.
Thanks, David. And as Amanda's already said, the report refers to February performance, but we actually published March performance last week as well. So I'll talk a bit about both of those and then also the work that's going on to make sure we deliver what we need to do in the future as well. So continued strong performance on the 104 objective with a further really significant reduction in last week's stats, down to about 16,000 from 23,000 in the previous month. On our operational daily and weekly stats, that continues and has continued so far. So we are confident of delivering the July objective there as well. So really fantastic effort across the NHS. And those organisations especially who had the biggest challenge in the autumn have really stepped up and shown really dramatic improvement over that period, which is absolutely fantastic to see. So we'll continue to work with colleagues to deliver that over this next few weeks. But really importantly, I think, look to the future, and there's already strong plans in place to deliver the 78-week objective, which will be a combination of some of the efforts that we've made, but also really trying to focus on some new innovations and disruptive activities to try and really change the game and make it more sustainable going into the future. So very strong progress over recent months. The weekly and daily stuff that we can't talk about in detail now shows a continuation of that, and colleagues working day to day to just make sure we get to where we need to in June, but also go beyond that and make sure we deliver this in a sustainable way for our patients over this next couple of years. So I'm happy to stop there, Richard, and take any questions if there are any.
So can I see who has a... Well, yes, sorry, hi, Will. You have a question, I think, for Jim, but fire away.
Thanks, Richard. Jim, hi. Thanks for the good work you're doing and the real focus on this area, which obviously is critical. There's a sort of balance between, if I call it good management, good disciplines, and innovation. Could you just give us a sort of sense of which you're expecting to deliver the most impact?
Yeah, that's a really good question, Walt. So thanks for that. In reality, in the short term, most of the gains are really in tightening the data quality, the PTL processes, a lot of the tried and tested methods that we've all used over the years, and we know the work. really to face into the challenge that we've got to deliver in the future, we're going to have to really disrupt some pathways, some methods, come up with new service offers. And there are signs of that happening around the country. So, you know, the one that we're all very focused on at the moment is the work in Norwich around their transformation of outpatient services. And I really think that's where a lot of the real benefit sits in the future. We always, when we talk about the list, get worried about operative surgery, but it is really important to remember about 3% of the list will end up having an operation, and 80% of the list will end a patient pathway in an outpatient or in a diagnostic process. And I think that really tells you where the activity should be focused in terms of changing the model of care going forward, and that's where everybody is focused. So I think short term, very much good old tried and tested methods. Long term, it's very much about changing the game.
I mean, Jim, it's Richard. That point you just made is one which I, so coming in as an outsider, I hadn't really realised, and I think I carried a misconception about what the waiting list was. And clearly, it's a very, very serious issue, and one we need to improve as fast as we can. But it was that stat is around 3% or so of the waiting list is requires sort of surgery with a multi, you know, an overnight or potentially multi-night stay. And I think it's under 20% requires surgery of any sort, i.e. probably day surgery. And therefore your point that 80-ish percent actually is of an outpatient delivery. And that changed very significantly for me, in my mind, how to think about this issue. It's still a huge, huge challenge. But then when you've been showing me and you have and shown to a number of us more granular detail about the particular, I'll call it the specialties, the volume of issues that arrive by specialty, it allows a much, much more textured conversation about, well, how does one profile and prioritise how to go after getting significant reduction in the backlog. And it's been a really helpful exposition by you of the sort of granularity of the waiting lists. Thanks, so thank you for that.
Thank you, Richard. Do we want to move on to the financial bit of this report, Richard?
Yeah, any other comments for, are we going to wait UEC for after the deep dive?
Yes, so that was the plan, Richard. That's the plan, yes.
Yeah, very good. And on the other, one of my priorities, which is primary care access, Claire, I think we'll see to what extent, I'm looking forward to hearing your oral update later on this call. So yes, let's go to Julian, financial update.
So two halves to this. Just completing 21-22, we've had the draft accounts from providers and commissioners in, and I mean, basically they reflect exactly what we forecast in the last board. Broadly, we are like landed on a pinhead on capital and on revenue against the final mandate. There was a £1.2 billion underspend, half of which is to do with underspends on ring-fenced budgets, half of which, i.e. about, you know, less than 0.5% of our total funding, is largely a reflection of the final outturn position for commissioners and providers at the end of 21-22. The real issue then is finalising and delivering the plans for 22-23. Significant progress has been made. We had the kind of final draft plans at the end of April from systems. We've been saying to the NHS that what we want are financially balanced plans that deliver the sort of performance activity goals we set out in the planning guidance in December, consistent with the assumptions that we set out in December. Clearly, one of the things that has really moved since then is inflation, running at much higher levels than the level anticipated in the spending round last November. But we've said to the NHS that where there are excess inflation costs, we'll need to deal with those nationally. But we want balanced plans. Putting that aside, now we've done a lot of work with providers and commissioners to identify what those inflationary pressures are. As they appear in energy bills, PFI contracts that are tied to the retail price index, or certain other contracts that are tied to the retail price index. You know, the fact that food prices are actually higher, the fact that we've seen 8, 9, 10% growth in the price for continuing healthcare packages, that is directly driven by the price uplifts that are going on in social care, as government policy also tries to align publicly funded and privately funded rates, or at least bring them closer into line. You know, fuel prices are higher for the ambulance service. So we are going to allocate another £1.5 billion to systems to cover those costs. And we are therefore now in the process of finalising plans with systems and making good progress in finalising those plans. I mean, clearly the other thing that has changed compared to some of the assumptions in September is the level of COVID as we went through January, February, March, April, May, as Amanda alluded to. That clearly is having an impact on the level of activity, the global level of activity currently being delivered, compared with the assumptions when we, you know, originally reached the agreement with government back in September. So we're just looking at what that means and how that plays through as we seek to finalise plans, which we are aiming to do before the end of June, so that we can finish the first quarter, get the establishment of integrated care boards sort of properly, you know, on a good, firm foundation.
Thank you. And as you look forward, Julian, and working with the Finance Advisory Group, and also working through with the Audit and Risk Committee, one of the things I know you're going to be thinking and looking at is that oversight of the engagement with the ICS as the funds now move essentially through those, as if I call them pivots in the structure. So that's presumably a significant feature of the work of the Audit and Risk Committee and your Joint Finance Advisory Group as we go through the next 12 months or so.
Yeah, I mean, the key thing is, how do we keep evolving the financial framework consistent with the goals that we want to deliver, and make sure financial flows, the payment mechanisms, incentivize, support the goals and priorities that we have.
Yeah, yeah. Any comments or questions for Julian? It's good to see that the we've been having a real go at trying to assess and deal with, and then actually to fund that inflation pressure, as far as we can see it, as it's coming through the various systems. That's been very good. Well, your hand's up. Good. Sorry, there are so many screens. I sometimes don't spot the yellow hand as people wave at me. But well, hi.
I shall shout next time. Again, very briefly, Julian, there's a very tiny comment on CapEx, and you know, we seem to have got a small underspend. But is it worth just saying a little bit more about CapEx going forward and how we're feeling about some of the real pressures around the state of our estates? I'm thinking about this given that Richard just handed me a task.
Sure. I mean, look, broadly, as we look ahead, we will be giving about £4 billion to systems as sort of core allocations to work out how they can, you know, which it's their choice as to how they invest, how they spend that money. And most of it will go on maintaining the estate, replacing equipment, minor, I mean, in the grand scheme of things, you know, sort of modernization programs. I mean, clearly there are priorities for us to stabilize what was, over the back half of the last decade, a rapidly growing level of kind of backlog maintenance, and sort of critical infrastructure risk. And I think with the capital we've got, I mean, in all honesty, the aim would have to be to kind of stabilize that. I don't think it is going to make massive inroads into that at this stage. I mean, we've clearly got a challenge we need to deal with, in particular with those trusts where we have very large element of rapidly aerated concrete planks, and that is, you know, where we are investing more money. It's a subject we'll have to come back to as we look at the sort of second half of this decade. Clearly, there's quite a lot of investment we are now putting into diagnostic capacity, which will improve the position on, I mean, literally just our capacity for scans, imaging, and into the digitizing pathology and imaging networks, which will significantly help our productivity as well. We're putting specific money into elective capacity. Again, the government has backed us with about £1.5 billion over the course of the next 3 years, a lot of which we need to use to create more protective elective capacity, not just to deal with the backlogs, but actually to make us more resilient against future shocks and indeed often just normal winter pressures. And there's clearly a big investment that we're putting into technology, you know, with the aim of basically by 2025 having no provider without an electronic patient record, alongside other things. But, you know, we will have ongoing challenges just about the quality of the estate, which we are going to have to come back to.
Well, I'm very grateful for you, to you, for leading on that piece of work, working alongside Julian. And I think it goes back to that theme of capacity that I want us to focus, that I know we all want to focus on, actually. And there's that physical capacity point, which extends across whether it's the new hospital build program or the quality of the current estate, or it's the increase in the number of our community diagnostic centres that are being funded are being rolled out, which clearly helps. But there's a much broader and bigger question, I think, that we need to get our arms around. And I'm very grateful to you for being willing to lead on that. There's one actually. It's sort of going to lurch into this conversation as a tangent, which I apologise, but I do keep reflecting, Amanda, it's on the statistic that I think you shared with me in the past, certainly, and probably with a number of the other colleagues, that it's the number of patients who caught COVID and were hospitalised. And it's quite a remarkable number, I think, because I think it's over 700,000 730 or something like that, 1,000 patients came through our hospital beds through that 2-year period. And it's remarkable, really, when one thinks that the capacity, the bed capacity is about 100,000. So you've actually sort of used 7 times the total volume of our beds in that 2-year period to manage the consequence of the pandemic for those patients who caught it, who actually required hospitalization. But it's a very significant, I think, example of the degree of incremental, more than incremental, additional pressure that the health services had to deal with. David, from an operational, and Julian, from a financial update, is there anything else you would want to add at this stage?
No, I mean, look, clearly for us, the priority is nailing credible, realistic plans and then just focusing on delivery and then turning our attention to how we set the right framework for 23, 24 and beyond.
Yeah, I totally agree. You're on mute, Richard.
Well, after all this time, I should have managed that, shouldn't I, really? But anyway, apologies, guys. I was going to say, Julian, thank you very very good, well said at the end there. I'm going to move us on, if that's all right, on to, I think it's item 5 on the agenda. So it's maternity and neonatal services update. Ruth, welcome. And I think you've got a number of your team with you. You might just want to introduce them to us. But I think you're going to provide us with an overview to the NHS response to Ockenden. And also perhaps some refresh of the strategy towards maternity and neonatal care. But Ruth, over to you, if that's right, to introduce your team and then to set the conversation up.
Thanks very much, Chair. With me, I've got Aidan Fowler. I'm looking at the screen. I've got Jackie Dunkley-Bent, Phoebe, Matthew, Sarah Jane, Duncan, all here to provide bits of the update for you. So since the last board, we have now the final the final report from Don Rockenden on maternity services at Shrewsbury and Telford Hospital. It sets out terrible failings suffered by many families, and I am deeply sorry for the loss, the heartbreak that each of these women and their families have had to endure. I pay particular tribute to Rhiannon and Richard, Kaylee and Colin, two families torn apart with the deaths of Kate and Pippa. They worked very hard, tirelessly, to ensure the NHS has this report. Thank you to Donna Ockerden and her team of reviewers for producing this Ockerden final report. I know that the NHS in England is committed to ensuring that the unacceptable experiences of these families are responded to. The report provides a call to action for all those who are part of the system, and we owe it to the families involved to learn and improve maternity care across England. I am clear about what we need to do, and my colleagues will set out three themes of actions to drive the necessary improvements: oversight insurance, leadership and culture, investment in workforce. But first, I'd like to turn to Aidan Fowler to update us on the Ockerden report. Thank you, Aidan.
Thank you, Ruth, and thank you, Chair. So I just wanted to give what is a relatively brief summary of the very extensive Ockenden Review of Maternity in Shrewsbury and Telford, which was commissioned by the then Secretary of State, Jeremy Hunt, in 2017, initially to look at the care of 23 families, but expanded very, very significantly over time. And the final report comments on the care of 1,486 families and a total of 1,592 incidents, some families sadly suffering more than one incident, and indeed in one case, I believe, three incidents. The incidents are dated between the period largely 2000 to 2019. There are a few either side of that. And initially, there was a report published by Donna Ockenden and her team in December 2020, which laid down seven immediate and essential actions for national maternity and 27 local actions, which we have been following up on. The final report was published in March this year. It contains over 60 actions for the local trust and a number of immediate and essential actions for national maternity, which are themed into 15 areas, but total some nearly 100 actions. Cases reviewed by a wide team of clinicians who've worked incredibly hard to cover such huge numbers have been categorised according to the type of incident, the standard of care and the standard of investigation in those 1,592 incidents, and the categories of severity 0 to 3 relate to either there were no concerns in care, there were minor concerns that they didn't think impacted on the outcome, or in the case of category 2, there were significant concerns which they believe may have affected the outcome. And in the case of category 3, there were major concerns which they felt did impact on the outcome for those cases. The numbers in each group were that 198 had significant concerns in the category 2, and 106 cases had major concerns in category 3, those constituting in the two groups combined, the groups 2 and 3, the significant and major concerns, that 9 related to maternal deaths, 131 to stillbirth, 70 to neonatal death, and 94 to brain injury. Donna Ockenden and her team are now offering one-to-one feedback to some of those families, particularly in category 3, and has written to other families. And a program of support is in place for those families. We maintain contact with Donna Ockenden and the trust to ensure that they have all the support they need. Thank you.
Sarah Jane, can I bring
in?
Yeah, thank you, Ruth, and good afternoon, everybody. So my name's Sarah Jane Marsh, and I chair the NHS England NHS Improvement Maternity Transformation Programme Board. So I just want to build on what Ruth said a little bit about the impact of Donna Rockerton's report. Obviously, Ruth's sort of fully acknowledged the impact on the families. This has also had a really profound impact on people delivering maternity services as well. Everybody has read this report with, at times, horror, shame, sorrow for what they've seen. And I think a really mature recognition that whilst there is quite a unique set of circumstances coming together at Shrewsbury and Telford, there are parts of this report that lots of people working in maternity services recognise in part from their services too. And this isn't about changes that we need to make at Shrewsbury and Telford. This is about changes that need to be made right across maternity services so that we've got the best of each individual part of care all the time. So I think we've been really, all the leaders have come together, midwifery, obstetric leaders, and said, what can we do? This, you know, we need to make these services the best that we could be. I think it's also difficult because there's a real balancing act for us here, because we know we have made improvements across the board in maternity services. We know objectively that they are safer than they were 5 years ago. The statistics tell us that, particularly around stillbirth and neonatal death. And we want to give the message that our maternity services are safe whilst recognising there are things we need to do to improve. So what have we been doing as a board? Well, clearly, as Aidan set out, it's really important that we implement the immediate and essential actions that Donna set out in the report. But it's also really important that we look for those thematic areas that we need to ensure have got national leadership. And so the three things that we've been focusing on, I'm going to ask now each of my colleagues in turn just to talk about these, are the board assurance and oversight, because often when things go wrong, we wonder where the board and the board oversight was at the beginning of this. What data and information were people looking at? How were they connecting with their maternity services? Why did it take so long to realise that there was a problem? So we have to strengthen the board assurance and oversight on the ground. The board's responsibility at local level, it is that safeguard of quality and safety, and we have to support the boards with the tools to be able to do that. So Jackie's going to talk about that. Then we're going to talk about leadership and culture. We need the right leadership and culture in our maternity services. People need the time to be able to do that leading as well. And then finally, the people and the infrastructure. Again, if you've not got the right people in the right place at the right time, it becomes very difficult to provide safe, high quality care because gaps emerge and make things more difficult and more fraught. So we're just going to cover each of those areas briefly, Chair, and then we will wrap up. So first of all, can I ask Jackie to talk through, please, the work that she's been leading around the board assurance and oversight? Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah Jane. My name is Jacqueline Dunkley-Bent, Chief Midwifery Officer. The Maternity Board Assurance encompasses many items, one of which is the assurance tool that's been developed specifically for Trust to help measure compliance against the Ockenden immediate and essential actions, both in Report 1 and in the final Ockenden report. And this, of course, is supported by an infrastructure of regional chief midwives, one in each region, deputy regional chief midwife, and regional obstetricians, because it's a multidisciplinary team that will help services to provide and have a sense of assurance. The process, of course, is strengthened by regional oversight and also integrated care systems, local maternity systems that will also provide assurance in relation to quality and safety. And this is further strengthened, of course, by the perinatal surveillance, early intervention and improvement support, very much badged under early concerns and surveillance. And that supports really organisations before they are challenged. What we're keen to do is to focus in an area that we frequently refer to as being upstream, supporting services before they become challenged, but using early insights from the surveillance model to identify areas that need support early, focusing upstream. And so in addition to that assurance, I personally, along with colleagues, Matthew Jolly, National Clinical Director, who's going to speak next, and other colleagues, Sasha Osmonro, we have been visiting maternity services and more specifically engaging with trust boards who have maternity within their portfolio. We have now completed 67 meetings with trust boards, and the focus of the meeting is really on safe, sustainable, it's really important, sustainable maternity care, safe, personal and sustainable maternity care, and looking at the learning from the past in terms of what didn't go quite right and what we can do within an appreciative inquiry framework to make things right based on previous reports and also in more recent times, the Ockenden report. And finally, I think it would be remiss of me not to mention the most significant part of our assurance, and that would be in relation to Maternity Voices partnerships. We know, the evidence tells us, that if we place women, birthing people, babies and their families at the centre, front and centre of everything that we do, and are proactive in co-creation, then we will be having assurance about safe maternity care. So we have Maternity Voices partnerships, and they are predicated on the mantra of no decision about me without me. So co-creation is taken very seriously. And we're also very committed. It's really important to us to have diversity within the Maternity Voices partnership members. And we are supporting them to ensure that they are diverse and represent the communities that they are representing. I'll stop there, Sarah Jane. Thank you.
Thanks, Jackie. If we go to Matthew, then, who's going to talk about leadership and culture. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sarah Jane. Yes, I'm Matthew Jolly, and as well as being National Clinical Director for Maternity and Women's Health, I'm also one of two national maternity safety champions, along with Jackie Dunkley-Bent. It's really clear that leadership and culture are two really important themes that have come out of the Ockenden report. And there's definitely room for improvement. But I would be doing a disservice to our staff if I didn't acknowledge that we've also got areas of great leadership and fantastic culture in our services as well. And we wouldn't have delivered the 25% reduction in stillbirth or the 30% reduction in neonatal deaths without their sustained effort. Nonetheless, it's not universally good, and that means it's not good enough, which means that we need to do something about it. And we have two funded initiatives in place to address these issues. The first is in relation to leadership, and the team who've been helping me develop this have been working with Sir Gordon Messenger's work on leadership and also with the NHS Leadership Academy. The first focus is on what we call the quadrumvirate. That's the multidisciplinary team that leads every maternity service, made up of the director of midwifery, the clinical director, the lead for obstetrics, the lead operational manager, and also a representative from the neonatal team. We think it's really important to have that perinatal approach to how we drive improvement. And so there's work on going ahead to develop that team to make them a higher performing team as we possibly can. And there's also work underway to develop our aspiring leaders so that we have a pipeline of leaders rather than people who are suddenly thrown into the post and have to learn on the job. We need to get proactive about this. The second funded area of work is on our culture improvement programme. That involves a diagnostic phase where we are using proven culture surveys to really get under the skin of units and are developing teams to help with that debrief to really get that recognition and self-knowledge of units to understand what's going well and what's going badly wrong with the culture of their units. And then we've developed a portfolio of evidence-based interventions so that we can develop a tailored solution for each unit to drive improvement and for them to own the problem and drive their own improvement. So those two interventions will be in the process of starting and are funded over the next 2 to 3 years. But I think it is important to acknowledge that we need to create the right environment to drive improvement in leadership and culture. And that means that we must resource our leaders properly. We've seen in our maternity safety support programme the huge variation in the time that's given to leadership in different units, where some units, a clinical director has half a day a week to lead a really complex large team, where other units they've invested more in the leadership and you see the benefits. And the same we see in our workforce. Again, a recurring theme in maternity safety support programme is that overstretched workforces start to crack under the strain and culture suffers as a result. So on that note, I will hand over to Duncan to talk about the next phase of our improvement plan. Thank you.
Thanks, Matthew, and good afternoon, everybody. I'm Duncan. I'm the Deputy Chief Nursing Officer for England and work with Jackie and Matthew and Sarah and the team on the maternity programme. I think it's fair to say that workforce is one of our biggest challenges and critical to the success of all of the programmes of improvement here. And just to, I think it's worth, Amanda at the beginning talked about COVID and the impact of COVID, but just to perhaps put a bit of emphasis on the scale of the support that our workforce provide every single day. So every day during the pandemic, approximately 1,600 babies were born during this period of time, which is the equivalent to one birth every 54 seconds in the NHS in England. And a midwife sees a first midwife appointment every 41 seconds in March last year. So that's the scale of just a bit of an example of the scale of why our workforce is so important, and the fact that we make sure we have the right workforce, as others have said, at the right time in the right place. So we're working really closely across with Health Education England, with colleagues at the Department of Health, and across NHS England and through our regions and our trusts and local maternity systems to work on increasing our workforce. So the £95 million that was invested last year, significant proportion of that was to invest in increasing our establishments, both for midwifery and for obstetricians. We put some funding in to invest in increasing the establishments by 1,200 midwives and 100 obstetricians. And what's really pleasing to see, and you'll see this in the report, is that local trusts have continued to invest themselves. So the increase in establishments has gone further than that. So 1,692 increase in establishment for midwives and 181 for obstetricians, and an increase in maternity support worker posts as well. But we know we've got challenges around vacancies in terms of filling that establishment, and also a particular challenge around leavers and turnover, which we've seen increase following the pandemic. So that's why we're investing really heavily in improving that. So we've issued out £8 million worth of funding to retention roles, particularly focused on midwifery, which actually I was a trust recently told me within the first couple of months of that role going in, they had stopped three midwives from leaving because of the work and support that had gone in. So I think, you know, making sure that scale and approach to retention continues, and we've obviously funded out to 157 units that support. We're also continuing to invest in professional midwifery advocacy. We've got 800 of those now. Really, that's providing restorative clinical supervision to our midwives and support. And that those support roles also providing support to student midwives. And we should expect to see this year, through the work that colleagues have done in Health Education England in increasing student midwifery places, increases of midwives start to qualify from this year. So we should start to see the impact of that. And building on the success of the international recruitment programme for nurses, we have launched last year an international recruitment programme for midwives as a short to medium term approach to increase our midwifery numbers. And it's good to see that actually we're now nearly at 500 recruited and at various stages of starting. And I was in Sherwood Forest Hospital a few weeks ago visiting their maternity and neonatal unit, and actually met with a a new international midwife, and also an international nurse who has been working here for some time, who's started the shortened midwifery programme, of which the places have been made available through colleagues at Health Education England this year as well, which is which was really good to see. In terms of investment for this year, at the board last time, there was a funding of £127 million investment announced. And a lot of that is going into workforce, and to pick up Matthew's point a moment ago, really to help with things such as time for clinical leadership, continuing to right-size our establishments, and support to recruitment and retention, both for maternity services and neonatal services. So you'll see in the report we've got investment to go into neonatal workforce, but then also capital to support neonatal capacity. So really great to see we've started to communicate those capital investments out, which should provide an additional 60 cots across our services in England, which will really support improving outcomes, particularly for those neonates that are born, those babies that are born under 27 weeks, and making sure that they have access to the right unit at the right time in the right place. So I will hand back to Ruth, I think.
Richard, just one final comment for me. So we have a clear challenge ahead of us to consistently deliver safer, more personalised care in maternity and neonatal services. We must challenge ourselves to do what it takes to ensure that we improve the practice, the additional investment, and crucially, working together with women and their families. We have much more to do. So the further learning we've got from the independent investigations, listening to the voice of women and families, and listening to our staff, we will bring together by the end of the year a refresh plan. I want to therefore just end on two quotes from Donna Ockerton's report. On page 150, Donna says, "We have seen so much excellent practice and a real desire to improve." She says a bit later on though, "As difficult decisions loom about NHS funding post the COVID pandemic, maternity services in England must not slip down the priority list." Thank you for listening to
Ruth, thank you. I'm just going to react, if I might, and I can see Wall has raised his hand. I just want to react. Thank you, Ruth, to you and your team for a pretty comprehensive review post the Ockenden report. I have to say, coming in as an outsider, I found it a truly, truly upsetting report. Truly disturbing and upsetting. And part of the solution you're providing to us goes to that capacity theme. And I'll come back to that in a moment. But Jackie, I did think the section you presented on assurance and direct engagement with the boards, and asking the boards essentially to make sure they're very focused locally on their maternity provision, I think was powerful. Matthew, I think the question I would still ask you, I heard it coming through, but whether we're now a sufficiently learning culture and a listening and learning culture. I know we're going to put the mother and the mother stroke patient, if she's a new mum, into the centre of it. And we're going to work together, co-create. But do you think we're really now a learning culture? And then I'm pleased, Ruth, that, because I was going to say, can you come back to the board? Because actually one of the reflections from the paper, and it was in Duncan's, you know, very cogent presentation, frankly, it's the scale of pickup that we've actually unleashed in the last few months. So, you know, national investment of £95 million to increase the establishment in midwifery by 1,200 FTE and obstetric roles by 100 FTE and so on. And then we're going out to recruit 450 international recruitment of midwives since October. I think it is, yes, October 21, joining the service. And it's quite a sort of it's quite a lurching, it feels to me, recent. And so I'm pleased to see that that's our reaction to what looked like as partly a capacity type issue, actually. But also I do note in Duncan's section, the still, quote, turnover of the midwifery workforce remains a concern. So I think it would be very telling. And it's a really important request that you do come back to us and just reflect as you talk about that refresh strategy on whether you now believe with all those steps we have a maternity service which we can, which we're really all confident in, I think, and that's important. And that's not at all to comment or criticise on the huge amount of amazing work that gets done by so many people in this place, but stepping back from it, clearly Ockenden, as which is where I started, was a truly upsetting report to read. So there's more comments than questions, actually, I think. But, Wal, do you want to come in? I think your hand was up.
Yeah, thanks, Richard. So I echo your comments around the upsetting nature of the report. I've spent time speaking with Sarah Jane, Jackie, Duncan, and Ruth offline on this issue. You know how troubled I've been about this ever since I've been on the board and it was first raised. And so please understand, as I ask this question, the background and context which I'm asking. So leadership and culture is at the centre of this, in my opinion. And yes, we can put resources in, and yes, we can have all the oversight we need and we want. But if the leadership culture isn't right, it ain't going to work. And so my challenge is, or challenge and question is, are we thinking hard enough about the sanction for if people don't follow the culture that we want, if there are a very, 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 very small, I mean, very small number of bad apples, what are we going to do about it? I mean, are we assured that we're going to have some way of addressing that? Because that's the bit which is kind of missing in all this, which is there's lots of things we're going to do which are good. I'm looking and going, well, hang on, the dark side of culture is people carry on behaving badly and you undermine your culture fundamentally if you don't do something about that.
So, well, can I, before you get a response to that, because David Behan is also... David, you want to come in, and then, Ruth, if you want to direct the answers to that, whether it's from you or from Matthew or from Sarah Jane or others in the team or Aidan. But David, do you want to ask your question or make your comment?
Thanks, Richard. Ruth and colleagues, thanks very much for that. It was very comprehensive. On Tuesday of this week, I chaired the Health Education England Board, and we considered the education and training implications from Don Ockenden's report. And to assist us in that conversation, we took the reflections from a student midwife, a first year student midwife, and an ST6 obs and gynae senior registrar. And both of those reflections were incredibly interesting, both in terms of this issue about the resource, that was the third priority, I think, that you touched on, and the great variability that exists for students undertaking their obs and gynae specialism about whether they've got time to train or whether they're part of the rota, and just striking the balance between the time to train and the rota. And I think it's worth flagging that, because I think this also speaks to some of your points, Matthew, about the culture that exists in organisations and the investment in training the next generation. The midwifery student was very interesting because I was trying to ascertain how far the curriculum, both for undergraduate medicine but also midwifery degrees, changed to reflect both Bill Kirkup's first report on on University Hospital Morecambe Bay, but then subsequently Ockenden 1 and Ockenden 2. And it was very interesting because there was a sense that it had influenced the curriculum. But what came out from speaking to some of the midwifery students was the sheer variation in just how much practice time, practice education was actually going on. These are not my words, these are the words of students. And I think how we, amidst the resource constraints, ensure that we are protecting student time for education, I think, is absolutely critical, because that's where culture begins to define for our future workforce, it strikes me. And where I would go with that, Richard, if I may, is Matthew, I wonder whether I could encourage some thinking as you begin to mature the work on leadership to think about practice leadership. So when the senior people are not around, the people leading the shift can often define the culture and the experience of new workers in particular. So the confidence to ask a senior colleague, how do I deal with this if you're dealing with it for the first time, strikes me as being a really important part of Richard's question about, are we still a learning culture and are we developing that learning culture? So that was the first point. And the second point, if I may, Richard, I was really interested to look at the annexes, Ruth, that you'd provided to the report, where you're taking us through region by region. And what struck me was the consistency with which risk assessments and informed consent, they were the most ambers on every single region of all the regions. And I just wondered whether that also spoke to Jackie's point about oversight and assurance as well, and it partly plays to the clinical, because it's clinical risk assessments that are actually being talked about as well. And I would have thought that clinical risk assessment was just a critical part of ensuring the quality and safety of people, yet it was the one that flashed most amber across most of the regions. And I was just fascinated by that, and I'd be really interested to understand a little bit more about that. So a strategic point and a technical point. Thanks, Richard.
So, Ruth, do you want to coordinate? Do you want to draw in whomsoever you want for your team to have a crack at those questions? Will's question and then David's.
Absolutely. Thank you. I'm going to ask Matthew and Jackie, as our board's safety champions, to have the first go. Thank you. Matthew.
Great. Thank you for all those questions. Richard, to come to your question or challenge, first of all, about whether we are more of a learning organisation. We've seen huge changes since the launch of the Maternity Transformation Programme and our capability to be a learning organisation. So we now have our perinatal mortality review tool and also the investigations from HSIP, which involve parents in the investigations, which I think is one of the most important aspects of how we become a learning organisation. So having the parents' perspective about what happened, what their experience was, why it went wrong through their eyes, has really shone a light on how we can improve our maternity services. So that's been really important. We've also developed our Maternity Voices partnership. So we've got women who are actively engaged and see what it's like to use the service, feeding into our knowledge about services. We've transformed our data. We now have a national maternity dashboard. And I think that helps us measure the numbers. But actually, although that's been very much the NHS way of doing things in the past, I think the capability that Jackie alluded to in terms of how we've developed our ability to gather intelligence about services and hear from the students who are using our service, from service users, from other organisations that interface with the services and shine different lights on our service, has been really important in gathering our intelligence. We've also got our Embrace confidential inquiries, which are truly world class. And again, engage with women and really deep dive into many of those most serious losses to understand what went wrong. And they have a really good engagement with many charities, many service users, many other organisations. So I think we are in a totally different place to where we were when the Maternity Transformation Programme started and our ability to be a learning organisation. And we have a lot of ways now of sharing that learning and turning the learning into implementing new ways of working. So it's all very well having the learning, but you have to make the learning count and implement change as well.
Thank you.
Can I just talk about two other things very, very quickly indeed? David, your challenge about everyone being a leader in the service, absolutely agree. And that triumvirate, quadrumvirate approach is mirrored the whole way down the team. It's the root cause of some of the worst outcomes. And we are working, we have our prompt training programs where people who work together train together. And we're working with this institute in Cambridge, who are again world class in understanding how teams work together, how you escalate in terms of emergencies, how people in the acute moments of a crisis offer learning, offer leadership and followership to work as an effective team together. And finally, Wal's point, I think the two sides of my response to Wall's point. One, we have process in place within the NHS to deal with bad apples. But I think a question we all have to ask ourselves is, why did the apples go bad? What's the environment those apples were in that made them go bad? Because I think it's a responsibility for the whole organisation to make sure that that doesn't happen in the first place. And I think it's about the environment we create, the leadership we offer, that is really important, because the people who go into midwifery, nursing and medicine, the percentage of bad apples at the beginning is very, very small. So, yes, we do need to deal with people when they won't change and won't improve, but we have to shine a spotlight on ourselves and understand our responsibility as well. Thank you.
Ruth?
Jackie, can you just comment on the students that David was raising?
And then I'm going to, and Jackie, and then after that, I think I am going to move us on, actually, because I'm otherwise going to get a very bad reputation for this timekeeping. It's a really important topic.
So I'll just respond to that question very quickly then. I think it's a question that I've heard several times before. Student midwives have at least 50% of their experience and their education programme within the clinical environment. And we're relying on midwives who are supervisors for each of these students, number one, to supervise them, to teach them clinical skills, etc., to sign off their clinical assessment documents. And that, of course, takes time. And within the context of the pandemic, even pre-pandemic, where we have staffing shortages in various organisations, it does create a challenge. But I think it's a point well made, and I will discuss this with our HEE and NMC colleagues. But certainly the challenge for midwives who are supervising student midwives means that they need space, time, capacity, thinking space to do that job well.
Jackie, thank you. Ruth, can I thank you very much and all of the team. I won't list them all, but thank you and all of the team for the presentation. And I think we will get you to come back towards the end, either the end of this year or early next year, to give us an update and assurance or more confidence, that we're taking the right steps. But thank you very much for the presentation and the engagement. David, I'm going to move to you, and I think it's an update. And I think you're being joined by Claire Murdoch and Tim Kendall, I think. It's an update on children and young persons' mental health and adult mental health backlog.
Yes, thank you, Richard. I'll personally be very brief. As is noted in the minutes of the last meeting, we said we would return to this to have a fuller discussion on where we are with our mental health service. I just think we've just noted how fantastic it is when you get the experts in the room. So I will immediately hand over to the experts. So Claire, over to you to lead the discussion on the mental health services.
Thank you so much. And can I thank the board as well for making this time to think about mental health. Obviously, you've had the paper, so you will understand that the headlines are, we had a plan, £2.3 billion to invest in mental health by 23-24, to see 2 million more people by that time across a whole range of services. So we had that in train already, and all I can say is thank goodness and thank you, because we've ring-fenced that money, we've been able to do advance planning. It was developed in a hugely inclusive way, if I go back. So we worked with third sector patients, professionals in the fields, policy colleagues, campaign groups. So although the NHS owned that plan and we have huge responsibility for driving its delivery, I'm really proud to say it's a plan that belongs to others, not just us. And I also just want to say a big thank you to Amanda and Julian, because the money is the starting point, right? It's job begun, not job done. But we've had huge support to make sure that every year the identified 2.3 billion or share of it as we grow that gets to the front line faster and faster. And that is imperative, and thank you for that support, because of course the thing we need to do is turn that money into delivery, which first and above all takes our workforce, not only workforce but mainly workforce. And so the plan has given us security, really, to think 5 years in advance and to come up with long-term plans. So the plan was really vested in wide ownership, proper funding that we had line of sight to, and a good evidence base. And that's where we were. Then the pandemic struck and the pre-existing treatment gap that the plan was designed to begin to reduce increased. And we all have our biggest concerns about those people who need to access care and support, who struggle. And that's what really drives us every day, not just us, the national team, but across the country. It's looking at really innovative ways to close that treatment gap. The plan isn't just one of more, it's one of different. So as we heard with the Ockenden article item just now, thinking about our partnerships, thinking about how we localise this, constantly looking at equalities and inequalities, constantly really listening to patients and their families has been absolutely key to what we've done thus far and will do going forward. You've seen that there are some things we did during COVID that we fast track. So we set up those 24/7 crisis lines a year early for adults, 3 years early for children and young people. And we did that because it feels like a long time ago, but when people couldn't leave their homes, when before we had the vaccine and we were in major lockdown, it seemed to us really important that mental health services open 24/7, at least by phone, so that people in crisis or who were worried could contact us. So thank you to the teams who did that across the country. We now get some 200,000 calls a month into those lines. You see that we also set up, and we hadn't planned to do this, this wasn't part of the plan, but we could see that the mental health of staff was really in jeopardy for reasons we all understand, and the mental health sector moved to set up those 40 hubs across the country, which are still functioning and have seen so many staff. We also, and I just want to pull it out, it was really important to us that seriously mentally ill people or people with a serious mental illness were not disadvantaged in how they accessed the vaccine when we began the vaccine rollout. There was huge concern, actually, that we would see the inequality continuing. And I want to say a huge thank you because we work with partners and colleagues and particularly third sector and community groups. And I'm really pleased that people with a serious mental illness during that whole period accessed vaccine rollout to the same level as the rest of the population.
So, Claire, it's Richard, can yeah. I just interrupt a moment because you should take the paper, which is a very good paper, sure, as read.
Okay, I'll move on
There's a phrase that struck me, which is that workforce capacity remains the biggest risk.
So
I would like you or Tim to give us some sense actually for how you're dealing with that.
Very well. I'll fast forward. One of the things that happened during COVID was we achieved one of the 5-year forward views, which was the strategy before this one, targets to grow the workforce by 19,000. And at the time that was set as part of the 5-year forward view, I don't think anyone thought we'd really achieve it. Well, we did, but I think that people knew that was a big ask. We did achieve that. So there's a lot to learn from what did we do there to achieve that milestone, which went nearly unnoticed because we were in the middle of COVID, that we're rolling forward into our workforce learning and actions now. The kinds of things that we are doing and that helped us then are definitely we're designing new roles. So the mental health support practitioner role, which we've seen in IAPT by a different name, in the mental health support teams in schools, we've got 2,000 of those new roles in train now. And we're about to roll out hundreds of new community transformation mental health support team practitioners. They're year-long posts. You can earn and learn. We've written their evidence base, we've written curricula, and we're working with universities, at least 13 if not more, who are both training and trusts who are employing these people as they go through their training. That's a really fast track way, given that it takes 15 years to train a psychiatrist, 3.5 years to train a mental health nurse, we can bring these people through bright, values driven, talented, and it's a really fast way of bringing a new workforce into service. We're also, of course, looking at retention, and we're doing a lot of work in that area. We're looking at training the existing workforce, and for example, in CAMHS, we trained more than 2,000 of our existing workforce in new interventions in recent years.
What's the size of the existing workforce?
It's approximately, I don't know what it is today, but it's approximately 140,000, and right, we want to grow it by a further 27,000. So it's going to be a mixture of new roles, fast track new roles, retention, listening to what people say about flexible working, exploiting digital capability, because we've learned during COVID that we can provide services differently as well. So it can't just be about working the workforce harder, we know that, but we can enable them to work differently. So we are rolling out far more digital capability, whether that's in the assessment place, how you book appointments in the single clinical record space, or actually therapy online. So we're doing a lot there to enable people to work differently and more flexibly. And of course, we're working with the Royal Colleges on how do we attract more people, the Choose Psychiatry campaign, for example. Okay. How do we attract more people into mental health? We do think that one of the upsides of the pandemic, and you know, if you can say that, one of the lessons that we need to bring from the pandemic is it's triggered a huge interest in mental health, and we believe that that is already generating interest in those new roles that I've talked to you about. I don't know, Tim, if you want to say more about that.
Can I just bring Tim in, and then I'm going to see if people have comments? But it's a very good paper, and thank you for the update. Tim, are there any points you want us to particularly emphasise from the paper?
You're on mute, Tim.
Should wear it on my T-shirt. You're mute. No, the only thing I want to add is that Claire said it about designing new roles. The way that we're doing that is that we're taking the NICE guidelines for that particular area of practice, and we're extracting the competencies of people who were involved in those trials, turning those into curricula, and then training people up to do them. So they're about as close to the evidence base as you could get. And we've done that in treatment of people with anxiety and depression in IAPT. We've done it for the mental health support teams in schools. I did the systematic review that was behind the interventions that we're training people to do. And we want to do that across every part of mental health. And we're just at the moment trying to appoint a national clinical advisor who will head that process up and sort of colonise the whole of mental health if we can.
Thank you, Tim.
Just on the workforce front, something that COVID really taught us was, in addition to our own workforce, if we can align more closely with workforce in primary care, in the acute sector, so in the NHS family, but also actually third sector colleagues, we're doing an awful lot of work with them about either parts of the pathway they can provide, which helps with the workforce pressure, the backlog and treatment and access and support, but also developing new roles that can go across third sector social care and into health. So there's been lots of innovation there as well, and I would like to credit our third sector partners for some terrific work in that area as well, which is both about culture change but also making more of available workforce across sectors.
Very good. I'm going to thank you there just to say I think it's a very good update, and it's a really important area of focus. First, one of the things that I was in a prior life when chairing one of the opportunity areas in Hastings was to actually have mental health as part of the educational intervention into the schools in Hastings. And it was a very successful part. It was a very successful, strongly delivering partnership, key workers into individual schools, helping those more vulnerable families and more vulnerable people. But Claire and Tim, can I thank you? I'm going to need to move us on, but thank you very much for what was a very clear paper and a very good update, and hugely appreciated. So thank you very much. I'm going to move us on. Amanda, can I ask you to introduce? I mean, Claire, I can see, or I have seen. Yes, I can see Claire amongst the celebrity squares. And Amanda, I think you want to introduce this item, don't you? So let me just hand to you.
Thank you, Richard. So just by way of introduction, I asked Claire Fuller to undertake an independent stock take back in November 2021. Why? Because the ICSs becoming statutory entities represents, I think we would all absolutely firmly agree with this, a moment of real change for the NHS and a kind of radical overhaul in the way that health and social care systems are designed and delivered. So my sense was that this gives us a opportunity, Claire's work, to set out a vision for primary care at the heart of communities and at the heart of systems that both addresses the concerns we've heard from patients about access, from GPs about workload, and from the wider kind of primary care community about recovery, reform, sustainability, but also a vision that builds on the opportunities from integration, from investment, and from innovation, including in new roles, digital technology, and new ways of working, particularly that were put in place around the vaccine programme. So a real moment for us to get around primary care in a different way. Why did I ask Claire? Well, Claire's a GP. She's also an ICS chief executive. Claire has extensive experience in a whole range of different roles. So what she brings is massive credibility, but also enormous energy to this work. So I'd like to thank her personally for what she has done over the past few months. And although we're obviously having this conversation in advance of publication, given the importance of the agenda, I think, Richard, you and I both felt that it would be helpful for Claire to give the board an update, just reflecting the importance of this work and the sort of timeliness of this moment, given ICBs coming into being in just a few weeks' time.
Thank you. It's an essential priority focus, actually. I absolutely agree, Amanda. So, Claire, to you, I think, for your reflections on your stock take.
Thanks very much indeed, Richard, and thank you, Amanda. So I must say that when Amanda rang me on the day of my ICS chief exec interview and I took the call, I had no idea quite what I was letting myself in for. So this has been an extraordinary 6 months. So as Amanda said, the scope was to look at integrated primary care, what's working in systems, why it's working, and how we can accelerate the integration as we move forward as statutory bodies. So the minute Amanda announced the stock take, I have to say my inbox just exploded. So hundreds and thousands of people in the end actually making contact, wanting to tell me what was going well in their neighbourhoods, in their towns, in their systems for primary care, things that they were incredibly proud of and that they wanted to share with other people so other people could do what they had done because they had seen real tangible benefits, not only for the population they served, but also for the people that were working in their practices and across their PCNs. So we had this explosion of energy. We had a consensus and a joining up of the ICS chief execs coming together, all saying, actually, we support this. We want to prioritise primary care as we move forward. We understand that primary care is the bedrock of the NHS and delivers, as we all know, 90% of all patient contacts every day. And then coupled with that, we've also had national focus, so coming here today, but also at national leadership events, a real focus, I think, for the first time in my I'm very old, my very long career, a real national focus on primary care. So I think we've had this real lineup of energy, attention and focus. But what surprised me with, despite the number of people that have come forward, actually the degree of consensus. So initially, the consensus is around what's not working. and actually what people have said is not working, and we've heard it here today across many of the items already, access, continuity and prioritisation. But then what was even more surprising actually was not only was there consensus about what's not working, but also an evolving consensus about what we need to do differently to make it better. So we heard time and again, and we heard example after example of people that have transitioned from the traditional sort of PCN, the primary care network contract, and have already moved into integrated neighbourhood teams. And what we've seen, and when you read the report, what you'll see is a commitment to moving towards integrated neighbourhood teams wrapped around practices, and a commitment to delivering three types of care in different ways. And again, the themes have come up throughout the meeting today, which is why it's been fascinating actually sitting in. So urgent care, we need to do urgent care in a different way. And if you look, so you were talking earlier about the urgent care pressures. Well, urgent care pressures start, don't they, in primary care. They start in general practice. They start in people's homes. But I think we often forget that actually the care that we can access from our own homes is not just about A&E. It's not just about GP appointments. It is about going to community pharmacies. It's what's available online. It's our sexual health services. It's our health visitors, our school nurses. The amount of urgent care that we can access is much broader than I think we traditionally realise it is. And then if you look at how people have started to organise themselves across their primary care network footprints, you can see how they're bringing together all of that available resource to deal with all the demand as it comes in multiple ways, as it comes in with people walking into practices, people phoning up, or people making digital contacts. So if you look at the very fabulous Pramit Patel and John Young in Greystone, who have created a single team that deals with all the demand on the day, led by one GP working with a team of people. It has revolutionised how they manage demand and how they look after people who have got urgent care needs. So urgent care was something that people agreed that we needed to do differently. One of the other bits is how we look after our most complex patients. So these will be the patients again, and we've talked about many of these patients earlier when we were talking about, again, urgent care and admission avoidance and discharge and flow. These are the patients that keep ending up going into hospital and spending longer in hospital and often having life-changing events by being in hospital too long and being unable to return home. We need to wrap a team around those people, increasing the skill set that is available. So this isn't just about one GP working in isolation. This is about GPs working with community services, working with secondary care consultants to give expert advice coming in. It's working with social care, creating a single team, working with a population that we've identified as being our most vulnerable patients. And the third thing people said they wanted to do differently was prevention. So we talk a lot about prevention in the NHS, but have singularly, I think, failed to wholesale do it differently. We started to do this over COVID, and you can see the real impact that the vaccine programme had and the completely different way that we started to tackle health inequalities, working with community champions. And as you travel around the country, if you see fantastic work going on, like the Healthy Hive PCN, like Andy Knox's work in Morecambe Bay, like Julian Oro down in Hawley. They are working in their communities. They are working with people on issues that matter to people and actually properly addressing health inequalities in a way that will be sustainable. So when you read the report, I hope you will see this real shift towards working in communities in partnership with people and organisations working for populations rather than for their individual organisation. But there is also a request that comes through for more support around estates, around workforce, around leadership and training, and particularly around data. And I think, again, all of those themes have come through in every conversation we've had today. So my conclusion is, well, it's 43 days until ICS has become a proper thing, before we become a statutory thing. And actually, as I've gone over the last 6 months, I think I've increasingly realised, we set out to sort out access, continuity and prioritisation. And I initially thought, well, you can't just do this in general practice. This is about the whole family of primary care, the pharmacists, the optons and dentists. But increasingly, I realised it is bigger than primary care. And having listened to the really good conversations I've gone on today, this is actually about how ICSs do, how we do our business and how we move from being complex governance structures and actually into vehicles that deliver real care for people in their communities. So if you'll just indulge me, Rich, I did have a list of thank yous, really. I've worked with an incredible team who have worked so hard over the last 6 months at ridiculous times of day, turning things around at ridiculous speed. So I did want to thank, well, I want to thank Amanda for asking me to do this, because I have, well, it's been an experience, but I have learnt more than I thought I would. It has just been an extraordinary experience. But the team have been fantastic. The ICS chief execs all coming together, uniting and prioritising primary care was something I didn't think would ever happen. And then the national focus we've also had on primary care. So I will stop talking, Richard, but thank you very much for the time today.
Claire, that was really very, very good indeed, actually. Thank you. And I look forward to getting and seeing the final report at some stage, but you have shared some of your emerging thinking, for which I'm very grateful. So let me open it up to any comments or questions. I'm looking for the hand signals to come up. Any comments or questions? So, Duncan, your hand's up. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, thanks, Richard. And I just really wanted to say thank you to Claire. I met with Claire yesterday to talk through this, and really the recognition around the wider workforce within primary care, particularly nursing roles, allied health professionals, and having spent some time in with a practice in South East London recently, really the importance of, you know, opportunities around advanced practice, advanced clinical practice roles, particularly leadership roles for nurses and other allied health professionals in primary care. And I'm really grateful for Claire for recognising and supporting those elements as well.
Thank you very much. Can I get, I can see David and Tim Ferris, I think. Yeah, David Behan, do you want to ask your questions or make your comments and then get Tim to do the same? And then Claire, I'll get you to respond to those. So David.
Thanks, Richard. Claire, thank you very much for that. And your enthusiasm is infectious. So thank you for that as well. It's more a comment, Richard, actually, and Claire. One is, I really like the framing around integrated neighbourhood teams and actually beginning to map a vision for the future that allows people, particularly at a local level, to begin to think in quite concrete terms about what some of these quite abstract concepts mean in practice. And I can see practitioners locally really engaging with the narrative, whatever organisation they work in. But I also thought your framing, Claire, from complex governance structures to a way of delivering, I'd really encourage us to think of that as being part of the narrative that we develop when this report is published. Again, I think it moves from what could be quite abstract policy into quite a focus on delivery, because we'll be judged by how this is delivered, not by the elegance of the policy architecture. And I think keeping that focus is going to be critical. So I'd really encourage us to continue to keep that as part of the narrative going forward. But thank you for the work.
Thanks, David. Tim?
Thank you, Chair. And Claire, thank you. It's been a pleasure. I've been a participant in the process and the enthusiasm of the team around this. And because the prize is so big and so important in this case, I want to just reflect for just a second, if I might, on my own journey as a primary care physician in a practice that had to undergo a transformation. And it actually is very similar to the story that I heard of Masood Nazir at Hall Green Practice, who I visited a couple months ago and told his story of transformation. And I want to emphasize a couple of points, and that is, practice transformation, changing the way you work and the way you have worked every day for years, and it is a really, really hard thing to do. And I just want to emphasize that we need to support the community of GPs and primary caregivers through a very difficult process. The way I like to think about it as a physician is that I want physicians to be spending 99.9% of their brain energy thinking about their patients and not about the processes around them that enable them to deliver services. And when you engage in a change process in the delivery of services, you are not spending 99.9% of your time thinking about patients. You are spending time thinking about, well, How do I get this new thing done? How do I, these are new relationships I have. And that's a, it's a big change process, and we shouldn't underestimate the support that will be required. The second is around data and the critical importance of using information that you collect on a regular basis to constantly check in. And I heard this very clearly from Masood at Hall Green. They had weekly meetings in which they actually tested how well they were performing against their goals for meeting patient access and experience measures. And I think that has got to be a central feature of the support of practices, is making sure that they have the information that they need presented to them in a clear and understandable way that allows them to make sure that they're on track and moving forward. So Claire, kudos to you on all the work. I really look forward to seeing the final product.
Tim, thank you. Let me, I'm not gonna ask, let me just come in if I might, by way of closure on this, although clearly we look forward to seeing the report once published and getting behind it. What to say really? I was struck when I first came in, and someone's just used the statistic that over 90% of the population's engagement with the health services in primary care. And I would also say, which is not a criticism at all, was Ian has done a superb job, I think, leading as one of his responsibilities, the work into primary care. But one of the things I personally want to do is to see the voice of primary care louder in NHS England, partly because of that 90%, but also partly, I think, because of the things that Claire has been talking about a sort of a multidisciplinary service delivery in the community through the primary care practices. Probably in my rather layman's and simplistic view, revolving around the GPs as the senior, most experienced, relevant clinicians, but orchestrating a wider set of services or signposting to a wider set of services available to their local population in their community. And in many ways, and sounding a bit not glib actually, I can hardly think of a better or more aspirational societal role. And I apologize to all the hospital clinicians and specialists as I say it, but I can hardly think of a more important societal role, aspirational role, than actually being that primary care provider and coordinator of the delivery of primary care when 90% of the population's engagement is in primary. And I'm not being Pollyanna-ish, because it's quite clear, and one of certainly my priorities is primary care access, which is a significant challenge at the moment. And we're going to work hugely hard with quick action, quick wins, I hope, to see how we can alleviate that. But at the same time, there was something like over between 31 and 32 million appointments, GP appointments in March. 62% of those were delivered face to face. And then when I think about the structure, Claire, that you're looking at, and I absolutely agree with you, I think that the thought of the collaboration within the integrated care systems and the importance given by the chairs and COs of those systems and those boards to primary care within a collaborating system, I think is really powerful. And we've got, you know, I keep getting all my stats. I try to get the shape of it. So 38,000 GPs. 6,700 practices, between 1,200 and 1,250 PCNs, and an ability to cooperate across those PCNs in delivering service to the community. I think there's a real prize here, and it's a real prize in support of a workforce which is probably feeling under a lot of pressure, but which is right at the forefront, I think, of what we can aspire to deliver in terms of population health and community health. So I think it's a really important, truly important exercise that we're now embarking upon. So I want to speak very loudly for the GPs and GP practices, and I know that, Amanda, you do. And so I think we are, Claire, I'm looking forward to the report. We're going to get behind you and behind it on it. I'm interested to understand continuity and how that gets defined and offered and operated. And there are different views on the spectrum of what is continuity. Is it the GP with every single patient, or is it complex long-term developed conditions where the GP is directly the owner inverted commas of the patient? So there are different models of delivering that. But I think this is a really important topic to get at. And it's not just the access point, which is the first part of it. It's that evolving model into the medium term of how this gets better offered. But I do think it's a remarkable role, the role of a GP and the role of a primary care service provider, not necessarily a GP, whether it's a paramedic or a practice nurse, a physiotherapist, whatever it is. This is a really important exercise we're embarking upon. So Claire, for your work, thank you very much, actually. And as I say, we look forward to getting the report. So can I quickly move us on? We have one important item to close with, which is the National Guardian's Office. So we've got Jane Chidgey Clark coming, and the NGO is jointly funded by CQC and NHSEI, and they have an annual report to the board. And this is Jane's chance, I think, to reflect with us on progress made since March of 21, and also the key priorities of the National Guardian's Office looking forward into the forthcoming year. So Jane, if I can hand to you for a very relatively succinct intro to that topic, that would be really good. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Chair, and thank you, board members, for welcoming me here today. It's a real privilege, and obviously the first time I've come as the new National Guardian, following in the footsteps of Dr. Henrietta Hughes, who led the National Guardian's Office for the previous 6 years and was instrumental in setting up the network, which from zero to now over 820 trained guardians across a number of organisations, both within the NHS, independent healthcare, hospices, primary medical services and moving out. So it's an absolute privilege to be here, and I don't intend to repeat what's in the report. I just want to make a few reflections for you from my perspective as the new guardian and having been in post now around 6 months, and a bit of a state of the nation, and to reflect in order to encourage the board of NHSEI in absolutely setting that tone around speak up culture and the importance of it. The report is clear in some of the outcomes from this last year, and obviously we've worked along, as every other paper you've had today, in the backdrop of the pandemic. We didn't do any particular additional reports this last year. In the first year of pandemic, we did pulse surveys with our guardians to find out what impact pandemic might be having on speaking up. This year, it's more been business as usual in the sense of we didn't do any particular additional reports. However, we continue to see the key themes that came out in the previous year, still with bullying and harassment being one of the key areas where guardians are taking matters that people are raising, workers safety, patient safety. And interestingly for me, seeing some of the softer data coming through on the qualitative side on some of those areas, a lot that doesn't reach the bullying and harassment threshold, but the civility, the way people are being spoken to, either within teams or from leadership and managers to workers. And that feels really important. We know, I mean, you have a large directorate for improving culture within the NHS that I'm privileged to work alongside. And we absolutely share those values that we need to improve the situation, improve by our own role modelling, and ensure that leaders are doing the right thing by workers. So from this last year, there's been a growth in more guardians being trained as the guardian model is rolled out. And that's a really good thing. However, I did say in the report, one of the things that is concerning still is the inconsistency within which the role is being implemented. And there are still some organisations that are not implementing it in line with the recommendations. Some people don't have dedicated time, for example, don't have dedicated resources. Some guardians are telling us that their chief execs or their non-exec leads for Speak Up don't really know what their role is. Thankfully, that's a minority, but even to hear that it's a minority is a worry for me. The other concern that I absolutely wanted to speak to you today about is the potential early warning signs. Now, I'm not a shroud waver, but there is a decrease in the confidence in workers, both through the NHS staff survey, the four questions that speak to confidence in raising raising matters getting in the way of doing a good job, as well as our own Guardian survey. And both of those this year, for the first time, are showing a decrease in confidence of staff. And whilst that's a sort of 4-5% decrease, that is still, in a large sample, a worry. And obviously, we don't want to see that continuing. Why do we think that's happening? I think we think that is because people are still afraid of the futility that I speak up and nothing changes. So it's evidencing that people are heard and matters are listened to and responded to appropriately. And the second worrying trend is the high profile cases where workers may speak up and then they suffer detriment, and that fear of detriment is still very much there. Our Guardians are telling us that. So that wider piece of the potentially worrying signs from these two important surveys mean that there's still so much more to do. And I look to the board of NHS England alongside our voice to be talking to leaders about the importance of speaking up and getting the culture right within their organisations. And that includes national bodies as well as and the regulators, as well as individual service providers. I set out in the report the priorities for this year, and they continue to be aligned to the four pillars of the strategic framework for the NGO that was published last year, well before I came. So that's looking at worker, are workers able, do they know how to and able to speak up? Looking at Guardians, we lead the Guardian network, and are they well supported? Is the role being implemented? And we work very closely with your Freedom to Speak Up team within NHS England with respect to that new policy that is coming. And I want to make a plea today that as a board, I know you have very robust arrangements for your own internal speak up arrangements, but I want to encourage you to use that new guidance, both to be promoting it out in NHS organisations and those that have an NHS contract, as well as within your own organisation, to do a stock check against that guidance and that the implementation tool for boards that will go alongside it. Because I really firmly believe that as leaders, you know, we set the tone, we set the culture, and we need to be across all areas of the organisation, both your own, our own and individual organisations, checking that. I had the privilege of speaking to a board at NHS Trust the other week. And I was saying to them, you know, you're rated good by CQC. You have good feedback on your staff survey. However, are you confident that across all areas, you know, if I went and spoke to, you know, a team over there that work at night or a team over there out in the community, that your speak up culture is consistent across the whole organisation? So even for those that are good, we want to see and ensure that that's embedded really fully, not just across, you know, the mainstream. And obviously for those that are having more challenges around their culture, and we see that in some of the highly publicised reports, that's improving and people are open to looking and saying what's getting in the way of people feeling confident to speak up, and most importantly, that it's acted upon and listened on. It's great to see Naveena Evans here from Health Education England today, because we've just recently published our third piece of training, and that's for leaders. And I would like to encourage you, if you haven't already as a board, to have an opportunity to discuss that short, sharp leadership training and the implications of that for yourselves, and to be able to promote that amongst the organisations that you lead. So,
Jane, I think, sorry.
By way of conclusion, I'm really happy to take any comments on the paper, and just to say there's a lot of good work going on to improve speak up culture, but there's some worrying signs that we can't rest on our laurels, and we all need to be working as leaders to do more about this.
I'm going to pause and see if there are any comments. I mean, mine would be that I think you're quite right that a good speak up culture is an essential ingredient of any good culture. And certainly those of us coming, well, I come from outside, you know, predominantly a financial services background, and the speak up culture and the development of that and the promotion of that by organisations and leaders of those organisations is key critical, actually. So I think your report resonates very strongly, and I suspect not just with me, but with Amanda and her top team and with my other non-exec colleagues. And we note your report and, in fact, also the worrying signs, so we need to be watching for that. Em, you want to make a comment? It's going to be a brief comment because we're going to run out of time. But Em, you want to ask a question or make a comment?
It's just a comment, actually. So working together with Jane, we have got this guide that's developed and aimed at leaders. And actually, it's great that we're probably going to be publishing that at the end of this month. And that is a real practical guide about how can leaders both reflect on their own organisational cultures, their own leadership behaviours, and then how can we really make sure that we reach the voices of the most seldom heard. So it's just, it's good news, Jane, that we've got to the point where hopefully that's going to be published at the end of this month. So I wanted to just put that in front of the board.
Thank you. And Jane, look, thank you very much for the report and coming to talk to us about it. I appreciate that. Thank you very much. So I'm going to pause to see if there's any other business from any of the non-exec board members first. And then if not, Amanda, is there anything you want by AOB as we look, as potentially as we look forward? Are there any thoughts that you have that we might be thinking to look at?
Yes, thank you, Richard. So, I mean, I think we've covered a huge amount of ground today, and there's an awful lot to come back to, of course, in future meetings. But the one that I think we might want to log for our next conversation in July is particularly to come back on, given kind of your comments about capacity, some of my opening remarks about pressure, particularly around urgent emergency care, some of the comments we've just referred to in David's report about the upcoming deep dive on urgent emergency care in particular, and the way that that connects through so many of the other themes we've discussed today. I do wonder if perhaps next time we might bring back a discussion about planning ahead for winter, because even though it's only May at the moment, it will not be long before winter is upon us again.
Amanda, I think that would be, and you and I have, you kindly raised that with me in earlier discussions, and I think that would be, even though it would be a midsummer July discussion, I think it's very timely to be looking forward here and thinking very hard about winter, the provision of health service through the winter and what that will take. So I think that's a very good idea. Thank you, Amanda. Look, so let me thank Amanda and the executives very much for all the hard work that you're doing. My thanks to the board. Because I have this privilege of chair, I just want to finish just by just repeating actually where I think I am after this first 6 weeks or so, which is those three first priorities. And by saying them, it doesn't mean that other aspects I don't mention are not really important or that we're going to slow down our focus on them. However, on a personal note, that looking at the elective backlog hard, looking at urgent and emergency care hard, and primary care access are important. There are a couple of what I call machinery, but it's really big and complex machinery, which is the merger of the five entities, which we have to give effect to by end of March of next year. And it's the implementation of the integrated care systems, the boards and the partnerships. Again, we need that. They're coming to life in very few days' time, very few weeks. And then those priorities are underpinned, in my mind, by the very necessary work around workforce, long-term planning around workforce and short-term considerations of workforce, but it's long-term planning around workforce. And then this single word, capacity. And so what is the capacity of the service to meet the demand and likely growing demand upon it? And how should we think about that? And how can we lift our capacity or change the shape of our capacity to meet that future demand? And that may be more beds, or maybe more scanners, whatever it is, or it might be working practice change, or it's how we deliver technology, but it's a really rich and important theme. So if I can finish with that, and just my thanks to everybody for joining, I'll call the meeting to a close, and I look forward to seeing you all, well, many of you actually, next Wednesday for the deep dive on urgent emergency care. So thank you very much.